First of all, I want to welcome everyone to the 2017 Boulder Sports Hall of Fame inductee ceremony. Thank you for being here. My name is Marty Kibalowski. I'm going to be the host tonight. And so I'm going to walk you through some of the logistics for this evening so everyone knows what we're doing. First of all, we have a silent auction outside. You may have seen it, may not have. So please take a look at all the things that are for sale. They're going to charities. There's a couple of charities being represented here tonight. One is the Jeff Lowe Mountain Foundation. The other one is One World Running and One World Triathlon. And you'll hear a little bit about all of those charities tonight as the program progresses. So please take a look at the silent auction. If you'd like to make a donation without buying an item, that's also accepted. We will take that donation. So this evening, what we're going to do is we have three athletes that we're going to be inducting to the Hall of Fame. And then we also have our Cornerstone Award we'll be giving, so there'll be four people inducted tonight. The order of events are going to be, we're going to induct Jeff Lowe first. Second will be Colleen Cannon, followed by Arturo Barrios and Steve Bosley, who's our Cornerstone recipient. And I'd like to recognize we have some former Boulder Sports Hall of Fame inductees here in the room. So Roger Briggs for climbing, I know that you're here somewhere. Thank you for joining us. Lynn Hill, who won climbing last year. Steve Jones for running. We also have several Olympians in the room. They got recognized as the night goes on, as more Olympians roll in to galvanize. And I think it's important, too, to recognize what we're trying to do with the Boulder Sports Hall of Fame is not only recognize athletes and other people who have influenced Boulder and have had tremendous achievement, but also the ones who are young and are coming up and one day will be potentially in the Hall of Fame. And we have two such young people here today. We have Lila Lanning and also Selena Martinez Hernandez. Would you guys please stand? Both Lila and Selena compete in the Combine Mile, which will be happening again this next week. And I know with Lila, she also trains with Melody Fairchild.
Hey, Melody!
So, thank you for being here. Really, really appreciate it. So, as I mentioned tonight, I think each person deserves a round of applause. We're first going to induct Jeff Lowe. For triathlon, we'll be inducting Colleen Cannon. For running, Arturo Barrios. Good form, Arturo. And lastly, for our Cornerstone Award, for significant contribution to the city of Boulder, will be the inductee will be Steve Bosley.
Yay!
And we have some special guests here tonight. We have the mayor of Boulder, Suzanne Jones, is with us. The Boulder County Commissioner, Elise Jones, is here. And they have a proclamation for each of our inductees, which I won't spoil the surprise, but it's quite wonderful. And they'll be coming up to read their proclamation for each inductee as they are inducted. I'd like to introduce Anders Mavis. He's a program director for the Boulder Sports Hall of Fame. If you're having a good time so far and you like what you see, you can thank Anders for this. As well as a slew of volunteers to put this event on, so almost too many to mention, but it's important to mention Anders because he's taken on a lot of the workload to make this happen year after year. And this is our fifth installment of the Boulder Sports Hall of Fame. And the reason for the sports that have been chosen is they're the sports that represent the spirit of Boulder. People come from around the world to come to Boulder for climbing and for triathlon and for running. And that's why those sports are being recognized tonight. So we will begin with climbing. And I'd first like to bring up someone who has done some remarkable things in her climbing career and was the inductee last year. She claimed one of the greatest prizes in the history of climbing. In 1991, she did the first free ascent of the nose of El Capitan in Yosemite, something that the best male climbers at that time had never done. And she's one of the few female athletes in the history of all athletics that actually has exceeded the male counterparts in their sport. And her name is Lynn Hill.
Thank you. Wow. Such an honor to be honored at this event last year. Boulder is an amazing community with such a big heart and so many good athletes everywhere, and it's fitting that I've been introducing Jeff and my story with him because he is a big part of why I came here. His spirit and what he represented in this community and people like Robin Griggs and the whole community of Boulder has brought so many people from all over the world, and today I would have to say this community is probably the strongest in all of America. In terms of the community of climbers. So it is a great honor, and Jeff's vision, I don't have a lot to say, or a lot of time to say everything, but his vision is amazing. He's done things in all aspects of the sport, from rock climbing to ice climbing to the mountains. And I met him in connection with a film that I did here with Beth Bennett, another notable climber here in Boulder. And Greg is actually the sound guy on that. And I knew his reputation, that he was one of those many climbers that did the first ascent of Bright Hill Falls when people didn't even know that it was possible to climb and things like that. But he also brought climbing on the artificial walls to where they are today. They're going to the Olympics in Tokyo in 2020. And that's thanks to Jeff and his vision. And his partner, Bob Conrad, who did that film so many years ago. And what's amazing to me about Jeff is not just his climbing, but it's his heart and his vision. And I've seen that as life has taken away some of your capacities, your spirit has gotten so much bigger. And that's what I love about you, Jeff, to have the vision that you have and the humanity that you bring. It's amazing. So, George Lowe, his cousin, not his brother, is going to introduce or say some words about Jeff.
I'm really very fortunate because I grew up with the Lowe family. We all did all these activities together, skiing, climbing, I mean, everything else resided with our parents. And you can see some of those things if you watch Jeff's movie, Met with Him, sometimes. And I had my introduction to rock climbing actually with my Uncle Ralph when he was training his boys, Mike, Ray, and Jeff, to climb the Grand Teton. And they set successive age records at age 9, then 8, and then Jeff at age 7. It's pretty remarkable that anyone at age 7 would be able to climb up roughly 2,000 meters by incline, lay, and probably 97 pounds, and the king could actually hold him to the top of the mountain like that. And so Jeff was quite an achievement to do at that age. It's really fortunate I've lived in the same part of Utah as Jeff, climbing in high school. And eventually we started climbing in places like Yosemite. Here's a very young Jeff Tunnel, about halfway out there, at the end. We weren't doing free like then, but we were lucky for getting up at those times. And then I introduced the Canadian Rockies. Here we are on the north face of a north temple, about 1,500 meters above the ground, looking up over somewhat awesome life. And I have a rather unique photo here of Jeff, or at least actually doing aid climbing, and I don't think there are any other photos of Jeff doing aid climbing on steep bikes, where they're using metal conduit, electrical conduit for aiders. And then we went on to another great adventure, going to the places kind of the Tetons in the winter. Here's what the Grand Teton looks like sometimes, always like a great training ground for Patagonia, where we did west-facing Grand Teton in the winter. Alaska, where Jeff was unfortunate enough to break his ankle on our first climb. He was the vision behind our trip, just beyond where this course is. And I think our greatest adventure together was a peak called Laptop Mine in the Himalayas. It's about a 23,000 foot peak. Unclimbed in 1978 when we went to Egypt. It was the ridge of light and sight that you can see there. And it has about 8,000 and 9,000 feet of climbing on it. We're trying to do a capsule style where we connect and actually put fixed ropes. And here's Jeff carrying a load out. One of the remarkable things about Jeff was we were on this trip and we had been climbing for 15 days or so, carrying all of our own supplies and all the loads. And Jeff was going up this really steep overhead ice thing. God, this is so much fun! And to have a partner like that on a climb is just incredibly inspiring. We actually got quite high in the mountain and had a corner that we rode just below the snow peak in the middle. We go down to the snow lanes, about that high in the mountain. And unfortunately, Jeff came down with a disease he had earlier, maybe made worse by altitude. We were in a snow day for 4 days. They had camped on the summit. It was very clear, though, that all of us couldn't go to the summit together. And Jimmy and Michael Kennedy's and the people. It was very clear to us, being in line with what you hear about climbing, that if we couldn't put everybody on the summit, putting somebody else, a chance of getting somebody else in trouble, but it's time to go down together as far as there is somebody as a team. And when we were smoked that last night, we just smoked in the car, and how we came down. We started repelling the storm, and if I, how would we all go down? Next morning, Jeff?
So I feel great.
Recovered by dropping maybe 1,000 feet or 1,500 feet of altitude, and then he climbed again and managed to get himself off the mountain. There were 60 back and had almost 3 days. So, climbing Jeff has been my best climbing partner, and I don't have to express how much his combination of vision seeing what could be accomplished. His technical skills would probably exceed any other climber in the world for many years. His stamina and joy is probably not just over anybody else in the world, it's had the same qualities. So it's been an incredible experience living with my cousin in these years. But I guess I'm not even more grace which you endure the risk of your Hodgkin disease, the cerebral sclerosis, and taking all these physical ability of mind, thanks to one's life, and show more mental toughness, dealing with zealous, and overwhelming financial stress.
I think we need to recognize the American healthcare system isn't necessarily good to help people like Jeff, and I hope that we will help the Foundation, not the Foundation, the areas that Jeff will have with a little help to know the past week and struggle to continue this virus for years to come.
We have a little clip from our world premiere of Jeff Lowe's Metanoia, our award-winning documentary film. And then Mike Weiss, one of Jeff's longtime climbing partners, is going to say a few words.
It felt like a real race to the finish line for this to be done while we can still have it here in the premiere.
We did not think he would make it to this premiere. For the last 2 years, we've been told that he's got less than 6 months to live, and in May, he was told it was imminent. He's 18 liters per minute of oxygen. I knew that Jeff had been suffering over the years, but it was the first time I really saw suffering at a level that made me say, okay, if he can go, I gotta let him go and not hope he stays because it's painful. Jeff says, I'll take care of it. I'm like, okay. Like, what's that mean? He goes, I'll take care of it. I'm like, yeah, right, buddy, okay. But within a month, he was completely off supplemental oxygen during the day. It's been truly remarkable. I mean, to me, that's Jeff. He's still that guy. The doctors and the nurses are like, no one's ever done that. I mean, 2 years on oxygen, and kind of just decide, I think I'll get off.
They love the cast and filmmakers led by Jim Aitman. A big loving thanks to my family. Amazing thanks to all the climbing partners who shared the rope with me.
Thank you.
why? No question.
That's a great answer.
Hi, everybody. Anders told me it's like the Academy Awards and the music will start playing if I talk too long, so. My name is Mike Weiss, and I met Jeff in the early 70s, and we became friends and climbing partners. And the climbing ended long ago, but the friendship still endures. And I see this, we're doing slideshow and video, as a point of reference, early 70s. This is a little teeny tiny bottle of Yukon Jack. Back in the day, Jeff would knock back a much larger bottle of Jack before he would give a slideshow just to kind of calm himself. And I can only say they were wonderful shows, but a lot less refined than what we have. Anyway. Like all these others being honored here tonight, Jeff has an incredible resume, and if you would like to waste a perfectly good spring day wading through it, you can take a look at all of his accomplishments. But I'm sure that he would rather that you got out into some wild place and did something that brings you joy. And I say that because I believe that knowing the man is far more rewarding than knowing the resume. For many years, disease has diminished Jeff's physical ability, and as his body has fallen away, he has filled those spaces with greater humor, dignity, love, and self-awareness. He's also come to know how much more climbing gave him than he gave climbing. Jeff and I spent our climbing years together as alpine nomads, chasing the seasons as they warmed the Canadian Rockies or turned Colorado's ribbon waterfalls to sparkling icicles. We worked very little, were thoroughly unproductive citizens. In short, we were dirtbags. A snapshot of that era would be a summer arrival at the Canadian border, headed north to the Columbia ice fields. We arrived in a shipbox 62 Chevy Bel Air. Brakes worked, tires were fair. The boys at the border took one look and sent us straight to secondary. We were scruffy and long-haired and clearly living out of the Chevy. After having us empty our wallets on the hood and weighing the unlikely benefit of our being at large in Canada, they gave us the boot, headed us south and said, come back when you have some money to spend. We hauled ass for the nearest Western Union to try and squeeze some show money out of parents who viewed us a little less favorably than even the border agents. It worked out, we had a great summer and a hell of a lot of fun. In any sport that you share with other people, you realize you spend much more time not climbing or running or cycling. You spend much more time just together. And out of that comes the recognition that in the end, it's not about the climbing or the running or the riding, but about the bonds amongst your tribe. It's the reason that we all light up when we see each other after the so-called glory days are behind us. Jeff gives himself fully in the now to family, friends, his partner Connie, and the world around him. He's wise enough to embrace his disease and know that it has much to teach him. And as it teaches him, he teaches us something, not about dying, but about living. Jeff is a great guy, good friend with a freaky sense of humor. And as he reaches his final summit, I think he will be one of the few of us that can stand at the precipice, lean into the wind, and be delighted by what he might see on the way down. It's going to be a ripper. Much love, old friend, and it truly has been and is a great run. Bring up Connie again. As you know, she's Jeff's partner. I had to make partner, lover, caretaker, producer, confidant, but worst of all, his accountant.
So thank you very much. This is such a great honor to be here, and we're so excited. And I almost never write something, but I actually wrote something. I'm going to try this and see if I can be more succinct and to the point. So thank you for being here, and special thanks to the Boulder Sports Hall of Fame and also to the Boulder Climbing Community. Jeff is deeply honored to be chosen this year. He has lived and climbed in Boulder most of his adult life, but around all over the world as well, but based in Boulder. And he's been a lifetime loving climbing, loving his tribe, and deeply appreciating the great outdoors. He's always enjoyed giving back to his community. He was a very skilled teacher. He taught directly to students all over the world for many years. He designed clothing and equipment for low alpine systems, Latok Mountain Gear, REI, Marmot, and the list goes on. All of his designs were born from experience, and those enhanced the climbing experience for climbers all over the world, and still do. We get messages on Facebook about a pack or a piece of gear that people have had for 40 years and still love it. So it's pretty interesting. Jeff's written award-winning books. He's created instructional DVDs. He's been an inspirational speaker. He created the world-famous Murray Ice Festival in Murray, Colorado. And as I said, he's won awards all over the world, but it is especially meaningful to be honored at home. Today, people find great inspiration in Jeff's amazing ability to live his life as it comes to him, with grace, a sense of humor, and humility, and most of all, love. In 2012, Jeff went on hospice support. For 2.5 years, they told us that he was going to, you know, die soon. Well, in 2015, they kicked him off hospice because he went to the Banff World Premiere that you saw there. He went to Kendall Mountain Film Festival in the UK. And after several other trips, they said, "We really don't think this is a good match." And I said, "Well, he's no better. Why? How can you kick him off hospice?" And clearly, he was supposed to stay home and die quietly. So since he was not cooperating, they said, out of here. The good news was, what I didn't know is that would mean when he got a new wheelchair, he got physical therapy, speech therapy, occupational therapy, all kinds of stuff for a limited amount of time. But it was very clear that if you're going to live, there were other options available to help us. In 2015, Jeff was part of a study out of Boston Children's Hospital where 27 teams from around the world studied 5 people. 3 of those people got a diagnosis. Jeff was, every team said they'd never seen anything like Jeff's disease. So I always call it, it's most similar to ALS in that he can't walk or talk, but he's totally there mentally, as is Stephen Hawking. And Jeff likes to consider himself in a class with Stephen Hawking, so that's a pretty good partner there. But I also like to say that, you know, Jeff's just doing another first of summer. I still do a bit of that. People used to say, "Oh wow, Jeff Lowe, he's so amazing," and I kind of roll eyes and think, "Oh God, you don't know half of it." And now when people say, "Oh wow, Jeff, he's so amazing," I'm like, "Oh yeah, he is so amazing, and you don't know the half of it." It's really an honor and a privilege for me to spend my life with Jeff. I will also say it's the most challenging thing I've ever done, is to care for Jeff, manage his care, and run the Jeff Lowe brand. That's really my job. I learned my job is to go to jefflowclimber.com and see all the things that we're up to try to sustain our life. For the last 4.5 years, we believe that Jeff is going to die soon, and we're very grateful that he is not. I thought that I would just do whatever it takes to keep him alive and keep him safe until he passed, because I thought it would be quite soon. Well, in recent months, it's become quite apparent that it is not happening soon. And we need to think, for the first time, we're going to take the long view of our life again. We're going to make plans. We're going to talk about what do I want to do in the next 5 years? What does he want to do in the next 5 years? And then figure out how to make that happen. And it's a really welcome shift. It's also kind of scary and intimidating, is how do we float this boat for the long haul? A friend created the Jeff Lowe Special Needs Trust, which is a trust that people can contribute to that will help us, and that does help us to sustain this life that we have. So we are always appreciative of those who contribute to the Special Needs Trust. You can do that on our website also here tonight. And then we also have the Jeff Lowe Mountain Foundation, which is our nonprofit, whose mission is to celebrate the joys of climbing, secure access, and protect the mountain environments. And we work with other nonprofits in supporting their efforts, like the Access Fund and the American Alpine Club. A couple of years ago, we produced a documentary film about Jeff's life and his climbs, including his solo route on the Eiger in Switzerland. His solo route, Metanoia, on the Eiger in Switzerland. And for 25 years, it was never repeated, even by the very best. And it finally got a repeat, its first repeat, in December of 2016, which is very exciting for us. And all of that fun stuff is in our movie. One of our current project is to get that movie on a DVD and in digital download so that we can share that around the world more easily. And we're also working on Jeff's biography, which will certainly carry out our mission as well, with Jeff's contributions to climbing history, climbing lore, and passions are very much appreciated around the world, so we hope to be able to complete that sometime soon. We're grateful for the support shown here tonight. We have a table out front with his award-winning books, our DVD, limited edition, and all kinds of other stuff if you want to be entertained. And I want to leave you with an eye towards the future. Most people have to rethink their athletic pursuits at some point in their life. And recently a friend approached us with an idea for a fundraiser for the Jeff Lowe Special Needs Trust. He wanted to run with Jeff in a special wheelchair in Boulder. So I'm going to show you a little film that our friend made. It's quite funny. And so here it is, with Jeff at 66 years old. He can't walk or talk. And yet he's about to embark on a new adventure, running his very first 10K ever. And so check out our Facebook pages to see the future.
Suzanne,
as if not enough has been said. Well, while you've had a lot of national and international acclaim, it's still nice to know that your hometown supports you. So we want to read a proclamation from the city of Boulder.
But first, I gotta say, there's a poster of you ice climbing in our house in my 12-year-old niece's room, because we got to see your movie at the Boulder International Film Festival, and she was so moved by it. So know that even though you're a pioneer in the sport of ice climbing and rock climbing, you continue to inspire new generations, not only by what you've done, but who you are. And we can't thank you enough for that.
Jeff Lowe is one of the most influential alpinists in the history of climbing. Amid his world travels, the Front Range of Colorado has been a home for Jeff Lowe since the 1970s. Jeff Lowe has done hundreds of first ascents all over the world. Jeff Lowe revolutionized climbing technology at least 3 different times. Jeff Lowe pioneered new climbing techniques and redrew the boundaries of what we thought was possible in climbing. Jeff Lowe's solo climb of the Metanoia on the north face of the Eiger in Switzerland ranks among the boldest and most difficult ascents in the history of climbing. Jeff Lowe's final challenge has been to stay alive while a cruel disease destroys his body. Today, he has outlived all medical expectations and continues to inspire people around the world with his fierce and graceful struggle. The award-winning film Metanoia documents and celebrates Jeff's story. Jeff Lowe is the 2017 climbing inductee into the Boulder Sports Hall of Fame.
The City Council of the City of Boulder, Colorado declares May 20th, 2017 as Jeff Lowe Appreciation Day.
Very inspiring, unbelievable. Wow, okay. I'm inspired. So next up, we're going to honor our inductee for the sport of the triathlon, which you know is Colin Cannon. Prior to bringing her up, we have a short video we're going to show. And, prior to the video showing, I will be entertaining you. And I'm going to sing. Oh no, look, it's up, so I don't have time. Thank you. you're 2:30 behind. And then I saw Julie Moss turn around, and I said, okay, that's not good for her. You don't want to turn around, you should not go that way.
Right.
My coach always told me. So to introduce Colleen, we have an incredible athlete in her own right, and she's the person who brought triathlon to Boulder and to Colorado. So please welcome Diane Israel. Yeah.
Thanks, everybody. I was sitting here, Jeff, so inspired by you. And I thought, how do I introduce Col after this? And I just thought, love. Colleen is, for those of you who know Colleen, she is pure love. And Colleen just gives to every single person that she's ever known, and she touches thousands of people's lives. So, what Colleen brought to Boulder, the gift that I had to bring Colleen to Boulder, was that we just have a lot more love in Boulder because of Colleen. So, I'm just going to tell a quick story. First of all, I've been fortunate. I worked 14 years at Colleen's Women's Quest camps that she's been doing for 25 years, which have inspired and touched thousands and thousands of both women and men's lives. To have Colleen just, you know, she just, during our training day, she just wanted to play. She just wanted to create something where we could all hang out and just play. And she knew after she retired that she wanted it to be as fun as triathlons. So she created Women's Quest so she could have playmates. Tons of playmates all over the world, including Howard, her awesome husband, that she met years after. Yeah, awesome age. So I just want to tell you a quick story. I'm a little embarrassed about it, but I'm going to be honest and tell you the true story. So I had just moved to Boulder. I'm a full New Yorker, and I was 22 years old, and I got into triathlons. I was a professional runner, and I was very insecure as a triathlete because I didn't really know how to swim. And I went to one of my first pro races in Tampa, Florida, and Colleen was there with this hot babe, Phyllis Hines. The two of them were like, we're both 22 years old. And I was from New York, and in those days, we put either an A, a B, or a C on our caps because you were either a kick butt swimmer like Colleen, or you were a crap swimmer like me. So I put a C on my cap. And I walked up to Colleen, and I had no idea who she was. And I was this like little strangly runner. And I'm like, catch you on the run. Catch you on the run. And then I was like, who said that? And then Colleen looked at me as the southern girl. She said, what did you say? Why would you say that to me? You know? And she like freaked out. And I was totally freaked out. And meanwhile, we had this race together. And if you notice with Colleen running, pretty much nobody ever beat Colleen in a triathlon when she was running. I mean, Col just makes running look so easy. I was a professional runner, and running, you know, after biking for me was impossible. But for Colleen, she was just pure gracefulness. So after the race, she won it, and I was third, and I went up to her and I said, you're incredible. And sorry, I just want you to know it's my total insecure little me, New Yorker, totally freaking out, that I had to put a C on my cap, and you are an A, and I'm really, really sorry, and I think you should come to Boulder, Colorado. Because, you know, so anyway, long story short, I'm running a mountain race, and the next thing I know, Colleen shows up. She just shows up. That's what Col does. She just shows up. And we lived together for years. We never had time to eat. We were too busy training, so we would put every food in the blender, candy, protein, vegetables, stuff I don't recognize, and we blend it up and we just eat it and train. And then one last story I just have to tell you. we decided that we had to work on flexibility. Because we were overtraining like 10 hours a day. We were usually so tired for every race. But, so Colleen says, we need to do yoga. This is 1982 in Boulder. So we look up yoga in Boulder, and the only thing that we could find was the 4-H club, Kundalini yoga. So Cal goes, we've gotta chill out. We've gotta chill out. So I'm like, Cal, I'm so tired, I'm already chilled. She's, no, we need yoga. If you know Colleen, you always have to go on another adventure. So we went to yoga, and it was that breath of fire. We both passed out. Anyway, this is a huge gift to the planet. Thank you all so much.
And she forgot to tell you that on July 4th when I came in was the Mount Evans Hill Climb. And do you want me to just keep going? Thank you, Diane. So I came from Alabama with a banjo on my knee. And I show up with my bike case and she goes, we're going on this run. And so I'm like, great. Well, it was a half Ironman. It was straight up Mount Evans. And coming from sea level, I took off really fast. I'm like, this is gonna be great. For like 10K, I was awesome. I was leading. And then all of a sudden, something happened. The bear jumped on my back. Everybody passed me. I mean, I was walking. And even the people with beehive hair that were passing me. I ended up being the last in that race. I totally remember that. And at the top, I remember there was a lake. You know, at the top of Mount Evans, there's that lake. So I decided I would go for a swim. Well, it was about 30 degrees. A little colder than the lakes in Alabama. So Diane, Diane is the reason I'm here, basically, because she did invite me to Boulder, Colorado, and I came from Alabama. You know, I had read the autobiography of a yogi, but when I got here, I found all the yogis. I found, we just go into the Trident, you would see everybody. And I was just so happy to come and find my tribe, right? You guys feel like you found your tribe when you're here in Boulder. That's why we're all here. And for this night, I'd love to thank the Boulder Sports Hall of Fame and Anders and Michael and you guys for putting this together because it really is amazing. And you know, Sandrock I've known for probably 40 years since I first came here. He was the total Trident hangout. I remember he and Howard even had like a book club. It was probably the first men's book club. But, you know, I have to take you on like a little memory lane because, you know, Boulder is the hub. We all wanted to come to Boulder, Colorado, and all of us are the spokes on that wheel. And I wouldn't be here if it weren't for all the people that I trained with and the people that supported me. Really, because it's not really the athlete that makes it, like Arturo and I and Lynn or whoever else. It's basically all those people that we trained with that kept us going. That, you know, in Boulder there was all the great health food. We even had the Brilliant Cafe back then, and they made us a triathlon muffin. Yes. Remember that? They would like pour power, the guy there, he used to pour all this protein and vegetables in there. I don't know what was in that muffin. But we would take that on our long bike rides. You know, Boulder was so great. We had the support of all the running community that was here. So we had, you know, Lorraine Muller, who was a great friend of mine. She was here. We had, at that time, Ingrid Christensen, who actually taught me to ski. Before my, which I love now, Nordic ski, she would go on her treadmill for, in the morning, she'd run an hour, she would do her 10-mile run in an hour, and then go ski with me. So she taught me how to ski, and that was really awesome. But, you know, it was all of the athletes. I don't know if any of you remember, but we used to meet at Rocky Costello's house. I know all the old runners do, and then we would go for a run, but it was more of a community effort. So in the early 80s, it wasn't like this competitive thing, and oh, here I am, and you can't have my secrets. Everybody was sharing secrets. It was like, if we had a secret, we were sharing it with everybody. So that's why the triathletes, we were kind of weird, and we were on the cutting edge of weird. You know, we were in Boulder, but we wanted to take the best from the cycling community, and then the best from the running community, and then we should just swim wherever we could. You know, trying to find a pool was kind of hard, but we would swim wherever. But I remember those days when we would all get together and go running, And I remember how awesome it would be for a whole group of Boulder athletes to just be running together. And even though Rob could have blown us away, or at least, you know, Arturo, they would all run together. And I was like, this is fantastic. You know, for at least 30 minutes, we all got to be together and run. And so it was more of a family. We kind of had a really nice, tight-knit family. Diane was only responsible. She got me here. So in that family, we had, in the cycling community too, there were the core cycling team and the 7-Eleven team, and those guys with, this is like jogging my memory. It's like, Mike Leahy came from Colorado Springs and used to work on us, and he developed something called ART, which is very famous now. So we had that in the old days. We had, with all the body stuff in Boulder, Lorraine started the Mind-Body Connections. You guys remember that? That store in Boulder? So that was definitely like 25 years before its time. So these are kind of like all the old Boulder stories. And I certainly wouldn't be here if it wasn't for everybody on that wheel. So let's see, I think Martha's here, and we used to run together every morning. Becky Browning, I run with her still every morning, ski with Tim and Karen. Just everybody that's here has been a part of that journey for me. And honest God, when she was pregnant with her first son 27 years ago, she just told me, she was in the pool with us, and she was kicking our butts. And that was like 27 years ago. She was 9 months pregnant in the pool, killing us. I'm like, what? Oh my God. And you know, Diane went on with to be this great. She's on the board in Europa now, and so we're just so proud of her. And Jean does the Voice of Sudan. So everybody that's here tonight is part of all of us that are being celebrated. So I'd love to celebrate all of you as well. So it's just I feel very honored and blessed as well. I'd like to leave you with one of my favorite quotes by Hafiz, or I guess it's a poem. So it's, God speaks to each of us as he makes us, then walks with us silently into the night. These are the words we dimly hear. You, send me on your recall, go to the limits of your longing and embody me. Flare up like a flame and make great big shadows that I can move in. Let everything happen to you, beauty and terror. Just keep going, because no feeling is final. Don't let yourself lose me. And nearby, there's a country they call life, and you will know it by its seriousness. Give me your hand. So Boulder's been this amazing place for us to find our tribe, where we have this complete terror and this beauty and this, like, this adventures, all this amazing things that we get to do in this life. And it's also been a place where we can find our connection. And so I feel very fortunate that I'm being honored here tonight to, like, keep that connection alive and keep our dreams alive. When I was in the sixth grade, I mean, this is really amazing. When I was in the sixth grade, somebody just reminded me, they sent me the little time capsule. And in the time capsule, I put down, you know, what you wanted for your future. And what I said in there was I was going to move to Colorado. I was going to live in Colorado. I was going to have two white horses. And I was going to marry John Denver. Everything for my whole life. I think we've been married for 29 years now, and it's just been, you know, he's been the support of all those triathlon races that I was running. He was usually there, like, giving me snacks or making me things. And one time over in Nice, France, because Scott Molina and I had trained on chocodilly bars for all of our training, he had to bring those to us. It's like, Howard, you have to fly over here and eat chocodillies. They don't have them here in France. And he's like, okay. But I couldn't do it without Howard, and you know, everybody has that support behind him. And I really feel like my heart, I love him so much, and I feel so happy that on this planet of all these people that I found Howard. I mean, really lucky that I got dropped in that regard.
At the airport.
With my bike wheels. I mean, really. So I do want to thank, you know, again, you guys for the Boulder Sports Hall thing, but also for Suzanne and Elise for being here, because now, you know, we're all athletes and we want to run and play in our forest, and we want to mountain bike and have fun, and they're taking care of that for us. So So for all that you guys are doing, you know, to help Boulder County stay safe, and for all of us, right? And I'm getting ready to pass the torch on, but my nephews are here, and my family is here, and Aaron makes mosaic bikes here in Boulder, and Jack is the painter and the builder. So, you know, just being able to give back and pass it on has been really awesome for me as well. And again, starting Women's Quest with Anna and Diane and Lorraine, who's not here tonight, and Martha, who's been at Women's Quest, and Vicky, who's been in the back. We have all of the staff at Women's Quest. And all, for all the young people, like Emily Pickner, who's here, who's been an amazing skier, and the dedication that she has, you can see these young athletes coming up, and they need that support. So for all the new people coming in, and for all of you, thank you so much.
Which, since you're a pioneer and you brought the sport to Boulder, you must be one of the craziest. And it's nice to know you have big friends.
Oh.
And the second, Colleen Cannon won the 1984 World Triathlon Championship. He's all. Was a two-time U.S. national champion, competed on national teams, had more than 50 career wins, and well over 100 top three finishes. Colleen took the sense of playfulness, happiness, and joy that she had when competing into her role as head of Women's Quest Adventure Camps, having helped thousands of women in the past 20 years find fulfillment and a sense of life, meaning, and purpose. Colleen Cannon has for over 30 years been an advocate for safe and proper trail and forest use in the Boulder County Mountains, and remains a key part of what has made Boulder the best place in the world to train for any athletic event. Colleen is the 2017 triathlon inductee into the Boulder Sports Hall of Fame. The City Council and the City of Boulder, Colorado declares May 20th, 2017 as Colleen Cannon Appreciation Day.
First of all, this facility, Galvanize, is new. And I don't know if maybe you've been here before, but it's really a nice place. And we want to thank them for allowing us to be here and donating the space to us. I also want to thank the Boulder Climbing Community, as well as Pizzeria Locale, who donated the pizza for us tonight, Avery Brewing. And then there's a whole list of folks here that I want to point out and thanks at El Dorado Water for what they did to help us tonight. So please a round of applause for our sponsors. For running, and we're going to have two people introduce Arturo. Before I bring those two people up, I want to say just a brief summary of the two. One is Mike Sandrock, who most of you know. Mike Sandrock is a 224 marathoner. He was a four-year letterman at CU Boulder as a walk-on runner. He also has written two books about running. Running with the Legends has been voted as one of the top five running books of all time. And he also, as you know, writes in the Daily Camera on a regular basis. When I moved to Boulder 20 plus years ago, I couldn't believe there were articles in the paper about running and triathlon. And I tracked this guy down. His name is Mike Sandrock. He's responsible for all of it. So Mike's going to come up, as well as Brian Nessler. Brian Nessler is the founder of Trail Magazine. He was the editor-in-chief for a competitor. And now he's the founder and editor-in-chief for an online running magazine called Motive Running. So please welcome Brian and Mike.
Near that world record of 27:13.81 by Fernando Mendes of Portugal. Barrios, a solo run from 5,000 meters. I must say that the Americans have been helping him out, not only in getting him to 5,000 meters in the past time, but Placentia and the other Americans have been getting his time. Padilla's been running out onto the track to him, and watch this as he comes up to take the bell. It's a superb run. 26.07, he's got in a 27.13. If he can do a 64 second last lap, that may be beyond him. He's really going to be one of the great runners of all time. We've seen Antigo run a remarkable run of 27.16, but Barrios is the fifth fastest of all time, and he could get some inside the Antigo time if this crowd urges him on. Mexico, the 25-year-old in superb form. We've seen some remarkable 10,000-meter running this season, and here's another remarkable run. No help from 5,000 meters on. The crowd urging him now. Another Kenyan gets out of the way. That's Huskar, and still he runs for the take, knowing that he's preciously near. The time he's going to beat is 27:13.81. There it is on the side of the meeting's European and world record.
Yeah, another round of applause for that. That's an amazing effort. How many people have run the Boulder here? How many people have run 27 minutes to the Boulder? It's all relevant, right? So Arturo, obviously, certainly is one of the all-time greats, both for Boulder, but for, obviously, the world. I get to travel the world and interview athletes all over the world, interview athletes here, some of the greats that are here tonight, Melody and Jonesy, and of course, we have Frank, we have all kinds of runners that have influenced people. I always tell people, you know, it's not the elites, it's actually the population of Boulder that is inspired to do great things. And this morning I was doing my modest workout on Marshall Road, and I saw Claire Gallagher, the Leadville 100 champion. That's what it's all about, right? And we go out there, we do our thing, and yet it is about the elites, because those people set the example for what Boulder is, and they made this name for Boulder. I was one of these college kids in the late 1980s, early 1990s, and I read that story in Sports Illustrated, and I want to come out here and see those guys. And I never became that runner, but I saw Arturo and Mark Mateo and Mark Platchus and Jonesy training. I was like, whoa, you know? So Arturo certainly, you know, running 27.08, that's ridiculous because it's still competitive now. And he was the first guy to run under 1 hour for a half marathon. Think about that. Who's run a half marathon? Under 1 hour. That's still competitive today. So being, you know, some people have graced us with their vision, Colleen and Jeff, in much respect to both of you guys, and some people have graced us with pure athleticism too. And these times, again, that are still competitive today are what really make, you know, what Arturo did very special. And so certainly, you know, we're 25, 30 years on, and to run 27.08 today would be amazing. So Arturo, wherever.
He's there.
Oh, much respect to that, and certainly, again, he is one of the all-time greats for Boulder, but also worldwide.
Boy, what a run to the tape! An astonishing last lap. That being Costa there, who eased over to Edinburgh. A remarkable run. What a jump he's taken off Mamini's record. We thought we'd seen Antigo run an astonishing time. But this, it means that the 27-minute barrier is possible. 27.08.24. Barrios of Mexico, the new world record.
They called him the metronome. When you saw his form there, the French newspapers called him that, because just like Jeff and just like Colby, athletes in their pure, when they're in a pure state, you get in that flow of form. It's just like a writer or an artist or people at the very top of the profession, and Arturo is that. And even more remarkable for Arturo, there's people who run fast times, and that's okay in and of itself, but Arturo's got a special story. that I think makes has some importance in today's world, because Arturo came, when he came across the border for the first time, he didn't speak very much English. He got a scholarship to a school in Texas. Took the bus from Mexico City, was going to drop him off at his nearest school in Texas where the coach was going to pick him up. Well, the bus stops at the border between the United States and Mexico, and they're going to change buses, go up to the school. It's going to cost another $5 to go from the border to the school. Arturo says, well, how far is it? Well, it's a couple miles. It's hot out there. Arturo gets off the bus, saves the $5, because literally he had no money in his pocket. Gets off the bus and with everything that he owned, two plastic bags. That's remarkable. No money, two plastic bags. One bag had some books in it. The other bag had some clothes. Walked to the school. Walked the 2 miles and saved the money, saved $5. So from that modest beginning to what you just saw there, he ended up becoming a millionaire. A few bad decisions, lost all that, and made it back. But I think that's just a remarkable story. And it just shows you that if you have that dream, and like he calls it, and like Steve Bosnick, who's coming up here just after this, you know, the American dream, that's what's really special about all of us here in Boulder being the center of it. We're just so fortunate. And guys like Arturo are at the very top. When he was a kid, grew up poor in Mexico City, and couldn't eat 3 meals a day. He couldn't eat 1 meal a day. So what would he eat? He would have, his mother would make him bread, and put the butter on the bread. And so the kids would fill the stomach, put a lot of sugar on the bread, and a little bit of coffee. Walk to school, a couple miles to the school, and walk back home. So he was doing the canyon training back then. And I thought it was nice that the announcer on the BBC announcer says, and the king of the canyon is getting out of the way. And one quick thing, and this is just my opinion, I go back to talk about Marty Kibalowski when he came here. It was really Dan Creedon, the late Dan Creedon, who was the first inductee into the Boulder Sports Hall of Fame. Neil Welk, who is coming up here in a minute to introduce Steve Bosley, they really set a pattern of promoting running here in Boulder. And so I think Neil Welk, who's going to be up here in a second, deserves a lot of credit for that. Talking about Brian mentioned, Brian was, and Brian says he's a modest, you know, Boulder runner. Typical, he's gonna do the full Ironman in a couple of weeks here in Boulder, besides working 80 hours a week, starting making a new startup. But just want to say one quick thing. If anyone reads the New York Times here, that you notice in today's paper there was a front page article about the Oregon Project, it's called, talking about the drug use there. And how a lot of their athletes, like Dayton Ritzenheim, Kara Goucher, who I went to see you, went out there and left because they didn't want to be forced to take certain thyroid medications. Well, we could ask someone, we talk about the 27-minute barrier, we could ask some of the people who ran faster than Arturo, well, they're not with us anymore. And I had one, when I was running with the legends, I had one Olympic runner tell me, he didn't want his name used, say that Arturo was the last clean record holder. So I think we deserve a lot of credit for doing that. This is a great story. So I want to introduce Arturo Barrios. And maybe I'll tell you a story about... He's got a lot of stories. We got Steve Bosnick coming up here. But one of the stories I like recently, he always says, it doesn't matter if he has no money or a lot of money, because he'll find a way. We found a way. But the story about when you first came to your first race when you had a one-way ticket is just wonderful. And anyway, congratulations on being honored. You're a huge part of Boulder history, and thanks for all you've done.
That's right.
Thank you for being here. Thank you. You might say that, you know, really, since I was born, really, I was blessed. It was a blessing. It was a gift. You know, because a lot of people ask you, how do you do it? Clean nose is a gift. And people said about, oh, you know, because my children are going to run fast because they have my genes. If that's the case, I would have a hundred children. Because every single one is going to run fast. That's not the case. It's a gift. And I was the one, I was the lucky one. You know, one day, being at the right place at the right time, I discovered I had a gift. And I just basically, it was up to me to use that gift. And you know, I was writing as I was growing up in Mexico and stuff. It was, I was one of nine children, mom and dad, plus grandma. So it was 12 people in one house, one bathroom. So, you know, but we made it, And then one day I discovered that I had this gift. And I was running, and somebody offered me a scholarship to come to the U.S. And my first question was, I have no money. And the guy said, no, we don't need for anything. Everything's going to be taken care of. And I didn't know anything about the U.S. All I knew about the U.S. was what you see on TV. You know, beautiful houses, and we see this is a developed country, a very, you know, rich country. And that was a dream to come to the U.S. That was, I'm talking about 1980. So I decided to come. My boss right. The bus went from Mexico City to the border. For five extra bucks, the bus was then taken to another bus, and then obviously go to the university. But I had no, I had no money. So it was only 2 miles, so I got off the bus. I said, for 2 miles, I walk, and I saved $5. So I did. I walked 2 miles. I got on the next bus, and I went to college. Yeah, that's how I did it. You know, I saved $5. But I gotta tell you the story about my first race. After, you know, when I was running for, I went to Texas A&M. I'm a mechanical engineer. I graduated in 1985. That's when I decided to give it a try to be a professional runner. Because I used to run with all these people, and one of those people is here, Steve Jones. Back then, he was super fast. He's not that fast anymore, but he was super fast. So I used to run by Steve Jones. Back then he was a marathoner, but he was also a great 10K runner. So, you know, after getting my degree in December 1985, I said, I'm going to give it a try. I'm going to see what I can do, running-wise. So I started training for like 2 months, January and February. And the race was in March, by March 1st, in Phoenix. But, you know, nobody knew who I was, because as you know, when you are fast and famous, people pay for your ticket, people pay for your hotel, everything's taken care of. But when you are nobody like us, nobody's gonna pay for you. So I had to find a way to get my way from Mexico City, because when I got my degree, I went back to Mexico. To find my way from Mexico City to Phoenix. So there was a small race in Mexico City, a half marathon, for $400. So I decided to run the race. So I ran the race, and I won. So I got $400. So I was 23 years old, and I was worth $400. That's what I was worth. So I found out that the ticket was $375. Plus back then, you didn't pay, you had to pay airport tax. Now it's included. But back then it was $15 to leave Mexico City. So it was $390. So I spent all my money. So I got $10 in my pocket. But I will never forget that the prize money was $5,000, $4,000, $3,000, $1,500, $1,200, $1,800 for 8th place. So I say to myself, all I have to do is finish 8th, and I double my money. That's gonna be a great investment. So I bought a, you know, a ticket, and I went there with $10. And then I found out that Steve Jones was there. And he was one of many, many fast runners. There were quite a few. All the people that I used to read about, every single one was there. So I'm thinking, this is a horrible mistake. Those, you know, I thought it was a great investor, but I'm losing my money. So anyway, the next day, there are so many fast people, and I'm really slow. But I said, I'm just gonna see what I can do. I just have to finish 8th place, and I make $800. So we start the race, we go super fast, and I'm one of them. But in 3 miles, there are 12 people left. And I'm counting and every single one. And so I had to be the four people. I had to finish eight. My 5K, when I got to 10 people, so that I had to finish. Just be two people, and I doubled my money. So we keep going, about 3.5 miles, we got to 8. And Steve Jones was one of them. And I said, this is it, I doubled my money. So I keep running. Then 7, we get to mile 4, we got to the 6 people, so I'm thinking 800, 1,000, 1,200. This is unbelievable. So we keep running. And then about 4.5 miles, we are down to like 5 people. So like I'm thinking 5, 4, 3, 2, 1,500. So I just went from 800 to 1,500. So we keep going about 5 miles. We are down to 3 people. So I'm thinking 5, 4, 3. So this is great. So I'm making a lot of money. And Steve Jones was behind me. Anyway, about 5.5 miles, we're down to 2 people. And I'm one of them. So I'm thinking, 4,000 people. This is my first professional race ever. So I'm down to 2 people. And, you know, with about 400 meters to go, there's a big, huge sign saying, you've got 400 meters to go. But obviously, you know, the people who are running, 400 meters after running, I'm a 10K. Seems like a long, long, long way. So it was a Kenyan and myself. So the Kenyan at 400 starts kicking. I go with him. At 200 meters, there's another big sign saying you have 200 meters to go. So then I started kicking. To my surprise, he doesn't stay with me. So I cross the finish line and I won. By then, there were no cell phone, there were no cameras, there was nothing. Just a bunch of people in the truck, you know, talking about the race. So I finished the race, and the race director comes running towards me. And he goes, do you know what you just did? And I said, yeah, I just made $5,000. And he said, well, yeah, but you just broke the world record. And they asked him, how do you know? He said, because I was looking at him, he's behind all the way from the beginning. So anyway, that's how I was introduced basically to professional running. That's when I really found out I had a gift. And everything was different after that. Everything was different. So when I think about my background, I'm very thankful for being at the right place, being blessed. You know, I have beautiful children. I have 6 children. And as I say, you know, I have made a lot of mistakes. But the most important thing that I learned about running and also in life, it's not the mistakes that you make. It's that you have to get up and keep going. Because otherwise, if you think about what happened, you're never going to recover. Never. It's like, you know, for me, when it was time to retire, I had an injury. Only one time, one injury in my life, and I ended my running career. I was just happy for what I did. I wasn't even thinking about, oh wow, you know, maybe if I can do this, if I can do that. I said, that's enough. I gotta do something else. And I did. But that was obviously, the first race was 1986, and I thought my that race changed my life. And 87, 88, and 89 came, and that was a track record. So that was obviously something incredible, because a lot of people ask me, what do you think about that race? And to me, the most important thing was that I'm part of history. You know, my children, we see that, especially now with the technology that you can go to the computer and you can see every single record. So my children see that, you know, hopefully one day I will have grandchildren and they will see that. And even, I don't know, here, my children would see, you know, what I did. And really, for me, it's just like a dream, being in the U.S. That a dream that I don't want to wake up. I just want to keep kind of sleeping and dreaming. Because it's been great. You seem to be really unbelievable. Meeting all these wonderful people in Boulder. And Mike was the first person that I met in Boulder. So I don't know if it's a good sign or a bad sign. But I think it's a good sign. Okay, Mike. And I have met a lot of wonderful people. Mari, and we run together. I see old faces, you know, Jackie, Brent, Don. We used to run together. Colleen was right. We used to get together in 1986, 87, 88, 90s, and just had a lot of fun. And run, and I was always amazed because all the ladies were very tough. And I was really feeling macho, and it's like, we're gonna drop it. And they looked back and they were right there. And I'm like, wow, these ladies are tough. But it was just a wonderful time in the 1980s. But too bad we don't have that anymore. But it was wonderful. But you know, getting back to this race, it changed my life because it was incredible what happened there. And I was obviously training hard. And to run 27:08, a bit later, I was the first man to break 1 hour for the half marathon. I ran 59:59. And I did. 59:59. That was my time, and obviously the other day, it was back in 1991. So it's been 26 years since I broke 1 hour. Nowadays, you know, I just obviously run, just to stay fit, it's 2 or 3 days a week. I cannot do it every single day because obviously I'm getting old. I have a lot of children that I take care of. But I still enjoy obviously Boulder. It's a great place, great place. I mean, a lot of people obviously since we came, they never left. And some people have left, but they always keep coming back. And for me, it's been very young, having my family here. My son is here, that I still remember when he was this big. Now he's way taller than I am. He's here, Alex.
Yeah.
You know, my partner, Allison. Family, Susan, Charlie. And I even have my CPA here. I have the business, I have my CPA, right? And all these wonderful friends. But, you know, you like to enjoy the race quickly. It was just a wonderful race because people that know about running, everything has to be perfect. You have to be in the right place at the right time when it comes to maybe the weather, because if it's too hot, too cold, too windy, but there's no way you can do it. So you have to be at the right place at the right time with the right people, and obviously have the training and believe in yourself. And it just happened that, you know, that day everything came together and I was able to run 27:08. And that record stood for almost 4 years. And now it's been broken obviously quite a few times, but that's just part of setting a world record. And then, you know, I came to Boulder in 1986, and just before the world record. And the reason I came to Boulder was because of the World Boulder. And back then, the Boulder was the Bank of Boulder. And the Boulder was in Boston. But 2017, the Boulder still was in Boston.
Yeah.
And I was invited to Steve to come to race the Boulder. And that's one of the races that I ran, only ran 4 times. And that's one of the things that I think about. It's too bad I didn't run it 10 times. Because it was a wonderful race, and I ran it 4 times, and I never lost. I won. So that's why, when I was getting older and slower, I told Steve, I want to run, but I just don't want to, you know, I have 4 victories. I'm going to quit when I get. So I never ran again, the Boulder. But the reason I came here was because of the Boulder. I was invited by the race, and then I decided to stay. And it's been wonderful. I've been part of the Golden Boulder for so many years. And, you know, I've been part of the running community, knowing all these wonderful people. And so anyway, so I can go on and on and on, but thank you very much. And really, I'm inspired by all these athletes because, you know, people say, oh, you know, you're a fast athlete, but just to see other people that they do that, it's just amazing. Like, you know, rock climbing, I mean, I would look at those pictures and I was like, oh, no way. I would never do that. No way. I'm swimming. There's no way. That's why I never tried to run a triathlon, because I was going to start sinking. No way. But it's great to be part of history, part of this Boulder running community, part of Boulder. So thanks for being here, and I wish the best.
Arturo, that was an amazing story. Your life is an amazing story. And your dream became the American dream. So thank you for that. So Arturo Barrios moved to Boulder in 1986 and quickly brought much publicity to Boulder and Colorado by being named Road Racer of the Year, and then as an ambassador for the city through his long international career as a top professional runner. Arturo won the Boulder 10K 4 times, won the Pan American Games gold medals twice in the 5,000 meters, in a still standing meet record, placed in the top 5 in the 10,000 meters in 2 Olympic Games, and was victorious in scores of road races around the world. Arturo set the world record of 27.08 for 10,000 meters in 1989, as we just witnessed, as well as world records on the track for 20 kilometers and the hour run. Arturo was the first man in history to run under 1 hour for the half marathon. Arturo coaching and giving talks to students, always with an emphasis on staying in school and getting an education. Arturo Barrios is a 2017 running inductee into the Boulder Sports Hall of Fame. The City Council of the City of Boulder, Colorado declares May 20th, 2017 as Arturo Barrios Appreciation Day.
Arturo mentioned he runs in our running group, and I was running alongside him like 8 or 9 minute mile pace, and I had to say, Arturo, how do you do this? How do you run so slow? Because you used to run 4:30 a mile for a half marathon. He goes, oh, Marty, that was just a job. That was just for money. I just run out for fun. Now to put some more in perspective about it, what you meant by that. By the way, he's a 5-time world record holder. I think they only mentioned 4, so make sure we have the record straight. So our last award is our Cornerstone Award. That's going to be given to Steve Bossa. We have a short video we're going to show first, and then we're going to bring up the introduction for Steve.
Colorado's most famous race, the Boulder Boulder, started as a simple conversation with the gold medal Olympic marathon winner, Frank Short. The 70s anchor, Anna Cabrera, shows us the annual Memorial Day run has become a beloved road race, uniting thousands around the world.
A family operation from the start.
I was 12 years old at the first running of the Boulder Boulder.
And now, Cliff Bosley runs the race his father Steve started back in 1979. 2,700 runners that first year. Today, 19 times that. More than 50,000 people from all 50 states and 18 different countries gathered to run the largest Memorial Day race in America.
When I sit back and look at it, it is really humbling. I mean, this is really special.
The running field bigger, but the values the same. A commitment to the community.
This was intended for the community. That's its bearing, that's its foundation, that's its where it came from.
And after 35 years,
it's still about running. It's still about the community.
Some runners. The supporters along the course.
The support of the city, the people in the city, is significant.
Everyone is involved.
They're serving bacon, and they're serving orange slices, and they're squirting water, and they have slip and slides, and they're out there, and they're cheering people on.
And making an impact.
The Boulder Boulder, I think, is about a $10 million, maybe a little bit more, $10 million economic impact on the community. It's a big deal for Boulder.
That impact stretching overseas to honor those serving our country on Memorial Day. The Boulder Boulder launching 10 satellite races all across the world.
It's for those servicemen and women who are deployed and can't come back to Boulder, Colorado to run the race. They get to run you can't be here, but you can run the Boulder Boulder there.
A community thank you across miles.
When you've got 55,000 people that will come together on Memorial Day, to remember what it's about, and we put on quite a ceremony, and that part
Induction that will always remain the core of this iconic race.
One morning recently, I was working on a computer and to the side back, we were looking at some old pictures and it stopped me. It said, my goodness, 35 years.
Ana Cabrera, 7 News.
It's a big deal. 7 News is a proud sponsor of this year's Bowl.
What's also is a big deal is this particular inductee award, the Cornerstone Award. To give you an idea, previous inductees, one was Gary Lacey, who's responsible for the Boulder Creek Path that we all enjoy now. And that was a very difficult task to complete, and he was an inductee. Another example of inductee for the Cornerstone Award was both Ruth Wright and Hal Bartlett. We can thank them for the lack of sprawl and much of the open space that we enjoy here in Boulder. It makes Boulder such a special place. And Steve Bosley is among that group that's had such a tremendous impact on the city of Boulder. And to introduce Steve, we have Neil Welk. And Neil's a former sports writer for the Boulder Daily Camera for 30 plus years. He was sports writer of the year for Colorado. And he's an award-winning journalist, and now he's at CU. So please welcome Neil.
Wow, what an amazing night. I just have to say I've had the chance to interview most of the athletes and most of the people that are in here. And it's when you talk about the Cornerstone Award, it's very, very fitting for Steve Bosley because all of you people are here. A lot of them are here because of Steve. You don't know about it, you don't know why, but Steve is the one that he and Frank Shorter, when they started this race, when they came up with the idea for the Boulder in 1979, Boulder had just started to become a place where runners went to go. Steve Bosley, his race turned it into the place for runners to go. It turned into the place for cyclists, it turned into the place for triathletes, and it became the Boulder we know today. And the economic impact is just a small part of it. The impact of the weekend warriors, of the people who have gotten healthy because of the Boulder, who have dedicated themselves to running that race. And that in turn spawned countless running stores and cycling stores, and it spawned health food stores, and it spawned the attitude that has made Boulder the best place in America to live. Every year it makes one of those lists, whether it's Outside Magazine, whether it's the Wall Street Journal. Pick your publication, they have named Boulder as one of the best places in America to live annually. And the guy who started, Frank Shorter, gave Steve Bosley an idea for a 10-day. Steve Bosley took it and literally ran with it. And Steve Bosley turned that Boulder into an iconic event. It is the quintessential Boulder event. The interesting thing is when Steve asked me to introduce him tonight, I said, well, you want me to talk about your time on the University of Colorado Board of Regents, where he ushered the university through one of the most difficult times in its history and has since turned it into a university that other universities around the nation come here to see how it's run because it's doing so well. He is the man responsible for some of that. It was because of his entrepreneurial qualities, what he did with the Bank of Boulder. When he came in and it was just a tiny little bank, and he did things that made it one of the best banks in the city. And I have to tell this story. I think I can dodge him before he gets up here. One of the things that Steve Bosley did when he was at the Bank of Boulder, he started a gift for a certificate. If you opened an account at his bank, he would give you a gift. Now, most of you who are old enough to remember that sometimes banks would give you a coffee pot or a vacuum cleaner or a set of pots and pans and if you opened an account. Steve took that up a slight notch. If you opened an account for a certain amount at the Bank of Boulder, you got a Weatherby hunting rifle. Now, I just want you to think about that for just a second. This guy was a banker and he gave away guns. And he did it in Boulder, Colorado. And he gave away guns. Now, it made national news, it really did. I mean, Steve was very good. He stood up and he talked to the TV cameras, he talked to the newspapers, and He suffered the editorials of probably the newspapers that I worked for, as a matter of fact, about how, you know, horrible that was that somebody would give away guns. And what Steve never did bother to tell anybody was probably the most successful promotion that the Bank of Boulder ever had. And it got him more free publicity than all the advertising he could have ever purchased. And it put the Bank of Boulder on the map. And now he's probably looking and being very, very unhappy when he asked me to introduce him. That, in all honesty, that showed the not just the entrepreneurial spirit of Steve, but it showed his innovation. And Steve applied that innovation to the Boulder. Steve came up with a wave start. And nobody had ever thought of that, but instead of having 40,000 people line up at once, why not run them in waves so that everybody gets a decent start? Steve came up with that. Guess what? Everybody else in the world is doing that now. Okay, every big race, they figured out that a wave start is the way to go. Steve came up with all kinds of fun things to do with a guarantee of the race. Today, if you enter the Boulder and you can't run, all you got to do is tell them. Guess what? They're going to give you a super huge discount on the race next year. Keep your t-shirt from this year. Keep everything. That's one thing the race directors around the country don't like, because they have to follow that up, because the Boulder does it, because they take care of their customers. And the thing that I always found interesting about Steve is I got to cover him as a reporter the day the camera started. I started there in 1981. So I didn't cover the first couple Boulder bowlers, but just about everyone since. And every year I would ask Steve, and then I would ask Cliff, you know, when he took over, I would say, you know, why you guys do the things that you do? And Steve really, very interesting. And when he talked about it, he said, we talked the other day, I said, why do you do some of these things? He said, it's not really complicated. He said, whenever you get ready to do something, you ask yourself, how do you best serve the customer? How do you best serve the community? And then you ask yourself, what's the right thing to do? And you do the right thing, because it is the right thing to do. If you keep that in mind, everything else kind of takes care of itself. And that's what Steve Bosley and his family have done with the Boulder. And I love the fact that all these runners, you know, we heard Arturo talk about he came here because of the Boulder. Colleen Cannon doesn't know it, but she came here because all the other athletes were coming here to train because of the Boulder. Every one of you in here has been connected with the Boulder in some way, I guarantee you. You know somebody that ran, you ran the race, you've been involved as a volunteer, but there are very few people in Boulder that have affected this community in such a dramatic way. And the really interesting thing is not very many people know his name. Okay, you go ask the 50,000 people that run a couple of Mondays from now who Steve Bosley is, they're going to go, I don't know. Steve Bosley, does he play second base for the Cubs? You know, but they are going to know what race they ran. They are going to know that they got healthy because of that race, that they made a commitment to run. And that's why Steve did it. Steve started this race not as a promotion for the Bank of Boulder. Steve started it because he felt a devotion to his community. And he felt a devotion to his home, and he had made Boulder his home. So he wanted his community to be healthy. So he brought in, he asked his buddy Frank Shorter, who, by the way, you know, when Frank moved here in the 70s, nobody had ever heard of him. And then all of a sudden they figured out it was a hell of a place to run. It was a hell of a place to train. So the two of them have kind of spawned a community that has just been amazing. I mean, it is growing. It is the community that we know today. And I can tell you, go on and on about Steve, but the one thing I can tell you from a journalism standpoint, I know this for a fact. Steve Bosley never did anything for Steve Bosley. Steve Bosley never did anything for his, you know, that was going to benefit him. He always did things for the community. He always did things for his home. He always did things for the city. They ended up benefiting him, and I'm sure he knew that. But it was never doing something for Steve Bosley. Steve Bosley did things for his community. If you look around tonight, and you look at all the people that are here, and if you look at the Boulder, and if you look at what Boulder has become, that cornerstone award, there is nobody better to earn that cornerstone award, because Steve Bosley and Boulder have become the cornerstone of Boulder, Colorado, and everything that we love and everything that we enjoy. I can say a whole lot more, but quite clearly, he's very deserving of the award, and it's really my pleasure and truly my privilege to introduce Steve Bosley.
Know right off the bat, if you're going to follow Neil, you got to know that everybody's going to say, who is that guy that Neil introduced? Following him to the podium is a challenge.
Thanks.
usually I speak without notes or just notes, but I realized as just now that I'm going to read for it because this is pretty emotional. This is very special. Thanks to the Sports Hall of Fame. Appreciate the work you did, and you know what it takes to put on events and what to do things, and you guys don't lose that credit. To say thank you, I am truly honored. This is humbling. I only scratched the surface about how I feel tonight. To share the stage with two athletes, Jeff, Colleen, and Arturo. Damn, is that intimidating. It's fun being around these great athletes. Trying to get a little bit to rub off. So simply, this is a tremendous honor. Thank you. First, I'd like to take the privilege to introduce just a couple of people. The guy right there with an entertainment drone that didn't know him. The first Boulder, he saved the finish line. It was screwed up. That's a whole other story. He jumped in, saved it. Didn't work, made it Boulder later. Been one of my greatest friends. You probably recognize his voice as he's the voice of a guy for all these years that was the calls of the play-by-play in the stadium. And after an extremely successful business career, he's joined us for another few months. Maybe we can talk to him to stay a long time club. Where's Joe French? He leave? Where is he? There he is. Longtime friends are a lawyer. He's not a lawyer, he's just a great guy. We've been through a few possible deals here with Joe. Been with us for 4 years. The mother of the walking division, Francie Bosley, gathered a large group of her friends together when her father was dying of cancer, and they walked Boulder Boulder. And that was the beginning of the walkers division. Boulder is unique in many ways. We're not going to talk about those. Tonight is sports, athletes, and fitness. Because you Boulder and are inexorably linked. Many communities try to lay claim to what we are and our reputation. They can only lay claim to it. They aren't. Boulder Boulder's only purpose is to serve the community. Likely, that was an extension of my being a community banker, which I took seriously. How is this described? How does it serve a community? Contribution to Boulder sports and fitness reputation. Reputation. There's communities that have all kinds of reputation. We have so many great reputations. How do you isolate them all? Contributing to the dedication of those seeking a healthy lifestyle. Our surveys show that over 75% say Boulder affects how much they run, how often they run, how intensely they commit. Described as anything from starting training all year round to starting walking further. Over 1.2 million people have crossed the Boulder finish line. Commitment to national and international competitive distance running. There are many we call them masters to serve. But we're not serving them. It's an opportunity to serve. And even maybe there's a crossover where it becomes an obligation we freely and enthusiastically shoulder. Provides Americans the opportunity to race with international competition to help them get better, as we say, to run with the big dogs. When we started, we were filling a niche that was just evolving. The world of international runners was starting to come to and train in Boulder. Except American women. We looked around and said, why is it that American distance running women were coming to Boulder? So we hosted for 3 years in a row a U.S. Women's High Altitude Training Camp. As we called it, the prime and pump to encourage American women to train in Boulder. Home many were down the line. We've maintained our commitment to the International Coaching Challenge. I don't want to say if somebody's right or somebody's wrong. Others have abandoned that, in my opinion. So if I sound critical, damn right. If the people who participated in the Boulder Boulder and the sponsors who sponsor us say, we think we have an obligation to represent them for international competition, and so there will always be grand international competition in the Boulder Boulder, Boulder, Colorado. The 2017 field and countries represented will be larger this year than most races in the world. We have the largest prize structure for race shorter than America. We've awarded almost $4 million, and more than a third of that has gone to Americans. Now, as we all know, this is in tennis and this is in golf, so the numbers are different. We added the prize money, bonuses for American performances. Again, I don't want this to be interpreted as being critical. It was a decision to merely say the first American wins money, regardless of that position. Didn't seem the spirit of things. So Americans are given bonuses based upon their performances. So it's a plus up. We call it the Boulder Boulder Olympic Training Bonus. As mentioned in the video, that the contribution to the Boulder's economy is over $10 million a year. Innovations and introducing new thinking contributed to our growth. We created a race with the elite international competitors and everyone else in the same race. At the same time, on most races, we're saying you have to pick one or the other. Maybe that's that challenge to say, oh, wait a minute. You say you can't do it. I don't know that we did it that way, but we saw that they were not mutually exclusive. In fact, they were beneficial. Races at that time, and many still do, say we're going to award prizes in 3-year age groups. So 15, 16, and 17-year-old race each other. That doesn't quite feel right. So in the very first year, we recognize races that recognize performances by age, by sex. Today we give 15 medals deep for each age. Cliff, how many medals is that? About, how many? 2,500. Now, one person said one day, well, that's, if you want to get my dad here and watch Cliff and me get excited, I said, well, that's like participation. There's never been a dream driven for participation. And when you are recognized as the top 15 and you've got 300 in the race, I'm pleased to do that. We specifically created the Walker's Division when nobody else was doing it. We realized one day in watching the TV that you had to look to find women in the race. Well, of course, they're slower. But that didn't make sense, so we said, let's run the pro races last. We had two races. And for the first time ever, there was a women's race inside a big race. There were women's only races, I don't take away from that. And we stuck with that. They ran the same course as the 50,000 or 30,000 at the time that were, that wasn't that anything. Had just run at a stadium and finished at a stadium. We've had Olympic runners say that it's the biggest crowd that they finish to and the loudest crowd other than the Olympics. With growth, we discovered the opportunity that we could do even more. The BB Racers, Boulder Boulder Racers, special training program we created for middle school kids to have a good race experience. We witnessed that the peer pressure of kids getting into the race and running with their friends, they were having a terrible experience. Well, that makes a lot of sense. It doesn't get out the race and have a bad time if we're trying to promote fitness and running. So we created a program, a training program, that teachers volunteered. Now 100 schools that participate in preparing their kids. It's called a preparation program also because there are kids who are intimidated by it. They've never been out for any sport. And how many we've discovered, how many you know, that are good athletes didn't ever have any idea. So let's reduce the intimidation and let's train them to have a good idea and have them have a good time. 25,000 kids have participated so far. A little bit of a twist, the rural communities started learning about this and a number of the smaller schools wanted to come. They don't leave at 2 o'clock in the morning. So we worked out an arrangement with CU where we pay for the dormitories for these kids to come and stay, run the race, and get a tour of CU. Now, I wouldn't say that my region happens on in that case, but giving kids an exposure to CU is a pretty good deal. The Memorial Day tribute, the largest in America on Memorial Day. 50,000 from a Folsom Stadium honor the 1 million Americans who paid the ultimate sacrifice. And we also recognize those veterans and those still serving. It might have even been Neil, but a reporter wrote, how many of those 50,000, had it not been for the Boulder, would have gone to Memorial Day tribute or ceremony that day? At a point a few years ago, Cliff and I were visiting, and about the intricacies of putting it on and doing it right. And doing it right is key. And we said, you know, this has involved the joint with 50,000 spectators and several hundred thousand people watching or several million over time. We have an obligation to do this now. Again, like I said earlier, not an obligation to embarrass them, but an obligation we enthusiastically embrace. The races at military bases all over the world, and even sometimes on ships at sea. Over 20,000 U.S. warriors have participated in Boulder all around the world. You know, it provides a connection to the tens of thousands that are here running on Memorial Day. And when they return, we give them free entries to Boulder. Each year, the Boulder is 50,000 stories. At first, you sort of hear that saying, yeah, yeah, yeah. The stories we hear day after day, year after year, with some people volunteering and say, running in honor of somebody or participating or celebrating something, it's turned my life around. The woman that weighed 340 pounds in the race right past her house. And she said, I can do that. And the first day she walked in the mailbox and could help me back. And she continued it, and 2 years later, at 130 pounds, she ran her first Boulder Boulder.
Wow.
One more person to introduce. There are many decisions I made about the Boulder Boulder. The absolute unequivocal best was when I asked my son, Cliff Boslin, to take over the reins of the Boulder Boulder in 1998. For the last 19, soon to be 20 races, the great successes and innovations Boulder Builder has experienced have come under his leadership. Thanks, Cliff. A final thought. I was asked why Boulder Builder. Perfect for Boulder. Boulder and CU demonstrate their commitment to a strong relationship, resulting in each being better. Boulder is committed to enhancing this invaluable relationship. Boulder is a shining example of Americans committed to fitness. Boulder is the birthplace of the running boom. Boulder's purpose is to serve the community with a focus to those looking to running and fitness and walking as an enhancement to their commitment to fitness. Uniqueness of the Boulder, CU, and with the uniqueness of Boulder, CU, and Boulder relationship, Boulder has been able to expand beyond the race to serve CU and the Boulder community. To ensure its primary purpose, Boulder enhances and expands the race with entertainment, respecting and upholding the Memorial Day purpose with its tribute, a top-level running international professional race, young runners programs, much more. And the Boulder community supports the Boulder. All of this intertwines in a special Boulder magical way. Thanks very much. I'm very honored by this.
forward. So unlike many of you in the room, Savannah might never run the Olympics or compete in them, but when you run the Boulder, and you're coming up the hill in the Folsom Field, and those thousands of people are cheering you on and high-fiving, don't you feel like you've won the Olympics?
Yeah.
Thank you for giving that to everyone. So I just warn you, this one's a little longer. This guy has done a lot. So, Steve Bosley moved to Boulder in 1974 and was president of the Bank of Boulder by age 32, quickly making the bank an innovator in the industry. Steve Bosley founded the Boulder 10K road race in 1979, a race that has turned into a yearly celebration of the best that Boulder represents, becoming a rite of spring for more than 50,000 runners and walkers each Memorial Day. The Boulder 10K has become the largest Memorial Day celebration in the nation, giving race participants, their families, and friends a chance to respectfully reflect on the benefits and freedoms we enjoy thanks to the service of others. Steve Bosley, as treasurer of the Athletics Congress, helped usher in the era of professional track and field by setting up the TAC Trust through the Bank of Boulder, allowing U.S. athletes to begin competing as professionals and openly accept appearance and prize money for the first time. The Boulder 10K, with its finish in Folsom Field and through its partnership with the University of Colorado, helped strengthen the city-CU relationship, one reason the race was named the best all-time 10K race in America. Steve Bosley was a member of the Board of Regents of the University of Colorado for 12 years, helping bring the university into the Pac-12 Conference and furthering its position among the nation's top public research universities. Steve Bosley is one of the key figures in the road running and racing boom that continues to this day, with his innovation such as the Wave Start, which is now accepted road race practice around the world. Steve Bosley, almost done. Steve Bosley continues to advise his son and Boulder race director Cliff, and remains an integral part of the local and national running community, having helped bring scores of Olympic and world-class athletes to Boulder, as well as helping thousands of young local runners through the Boulder Middle School Challenge. The Boulder Sports Hall of Fame is honoring Steve Bosley with his 2017 Cornerstone Contributor Award for his role and accomplishments in helping make Boulder a leading center of endurance sports, known throughout the world for its athletic population, both elite and recreational. The City Council of the City of Boulder, Colorado declares May 20th, 2017 as Steve Bosley Appreciation Day.
Happening. It's going to close 10 minutes after this induction ceremony ends. So please, if you can, try to make a bid for the auction items. It benefits the benefits to Jeff Lowe and Connie Sell, but also benefits One World Running. Quick story about One World Running. It was founded in 1986, and it's founded the idea of distributing shoes around the world to young people who wouldn't have shoes otherwise. So over 22 countries around the world to do that. In some of these countries, if the kids don't have shoes, they can't go to school. And because of this program, they are now going to school. And this program has arranged 500,000 pairs of shoes since that time. These various students, the biggest shoe is 41,000 pairs of shoes. It's a 100% volunteer organization. There's no paycheck being paid to anyone, including travel expenses to these countries where they hold races and give out the shoes. And they go to some countries like Belize recently, they have a list of 1,500 lower school, middle school, and high school kids by name, by shoe size, and hand them out to every one of them. So this is an organization we're supporting. So please take some time to either donate or look at the silent auction and bid on some items to help out. Really appreciate that. So a big round of applause for all our inductees, please. So this is, did you have something, Brock, you want to say? Okay. Hang on, sorry.
Or Monday.
Turns out we're good. So I want to thank everyone for coming. What a great evening. I really enjoyed it. Sorry I ran a little bit over, but I hope you really appreciated it. And I certainly did. Thank you.